People are pretty resistant to believe that behaviour like aggression is biological in nature, preferring to think that people are aggressive at least in part because of their experiences. Well, what experiences make someone aggressive? In this video on social psychological explanations of aggression, we're going to cover three: frustration aggression, social learning theory, and de-individuation. Psychboost.com, over 170 videos to help you with your qualification, and Patreon supporters can access bonus resources, tutorial videos, and the Discord channel. Frustration aggression. So first up is a concept thought up by researchers Dollard and Miller. They argued that aggression is, in one way or another, always caused by frustration. And this frustration happens when we're trying to complete a goal, but something stops us. Now, we've all been frustrated at some point, and it's not pleasant. It's a mental tension that tends to build up over time until you calm down, or with enough frustration, snap. Now, the frustration aggression theory is fundamentally a psychodynamic theory, and according to psychodynamics, releasing a strong built-up emotion leads to catharsis. This is a pleasant feeling of relaxation. Now, we can't always release our feelings of frustration on whatever's cause of frustration. So there's another psychodynamic concept called displacement, moving our aggression onto a weaker or more available target. So perhaps the boss has sent an email ruining the plans of an employee. Now, the boss is too powerful and not available, so the employee lashes out at his family. Whether frustration actually turned into aggression depends on a few factors. How close someone is to completing a goal is important. If you're just about to achieve your goal and then you're stopped, that's when you'll be the most frustrated. People are also more likely to be aggressive when frustrated if they've learned from experience that aggression isn't punished, but actually it helps them achieve their goals. So maybe a boss finds out being aggressive to his underperforming staff, doesn't get reported to HR, but makes them work harder and he's more likely to get his bonus. Frustration aggression. Evaluations. The first evaluation we have is by Gein, and in an interesting setup, participants were asked to complete a jigsaw puzzle. But in the room was a confederate. In one condition, the confederate was friendly, but interfered with the task, frustrating the participant. In a second condition, the confederate didn't interfere, but they did insult the intelligent of the participant. And in a third control group, the confederates didn't insult or interfere. In the second part of the study, the participants took part in a task in which they needed to shock the confederate. Now, the results do support the idea that if we're frustrated, that'll result in aggression, as a frustrated group shocked the friendly but frustrating confederate more than the control group. But it's only partial support, as the verbally attacked group gave the higher shocks. We could criticise Gein's study on the basis of being set in a lab, and the possibility of demand characteristics that come with it. A supporting study, which is actually pretty funny, is a field experiment by Harris. Harris very simply sent his research students to act as confederates and got them to push into real queues. Either near the front, so around two from the front, or near the back, at least 11 people before them. Now, the confederates then turned around and rated the aggression level of the person immediately behind them, based on their verbal and physical aggression. And it was found that causing frustration by blocking the goal-directed behaviour closer to the goal produced more aggression. A shout out to those research students, I really don't think I would have had the guts to take part in that study. But a final criticism. There's distinct variability in how resistant individuals are in getting frustrated, or even letting that frustration turn into aggression. And for that matter, plenty of people who perform acts of serious aggression were not frustrated at all. So the cold-blooded killer who murders a stranger, or the soldier who kills in warfare as part of their profession. And the idea of aggression providing catharsis is pretty questionable, as people who are aggressive tend to be aggressive quite frequently, and many people are never aggressive. So it seems that letting the aggression out really isn't chilling out those aggressive people. Social learning theory. If you remember approaches well, this one should be pretty straightforward. After all, you learnt social learning theory in the context of aggression with Bandura's work, and we'll use that as an evaluation. But as a reminder, social learning theorists agree with behaviourists that we learn from experience, but they take an extra step, suggesting we don't just learn from our own direct reinforcement and punishment, but from observing and imitating role models' behaviour. So with that in mind, we will imitate the aggressive behaviour we see in our role models if we see that role model getting some sort of reward for the aggression, a concept called vicarious reinforcement. But on the flip side of that, we're less likely to imitate the models if we see them punished for that aggression. Imitation is also more likely if we identify the role model. So if the person we see being aggressive is attractive and high status, but also similar to the observer's demographic, so age and gender. If we do identify with the role model, then aggressive behaviour they model is much more likely to be imitated. But of course, not all aggressive behaviour can be modelled. The observer needs to have some level of confidence that they can actually successfully imitate the aggression they observe. This is their level of self-efficacy. And this is likely to be higher if the observer has been aggressive in the past and it's worked out for them. And as it's social learning theory, aggression we observe will only turn into imitation if the four cognitive mediational factors apply. We have to pay attention, we have to retain or remember how to do it, we need to be able to reproduce, and we need to have sufficient motivation to want to imitate. But we don't need to see an immediate aggressive response in the observer after watching their model. They can internalize, storing that aggressive observed behavior until just the moment that it's needed. Social learning theory, evaluations. Okay, it's social learning theory, it's aggression. Bandura is certainly going to be one of our evaluation points here. Hopefully you remember the basics. In the Bobo doll study, children observed adults being aggressive with a blow-up doll. The adults hit and kicked the Bobo doll. When the children were placed in a separate room with a range of toys, those children who had seen the aggressive modelling were aggressive themselves. The control group, who didn't see aggression, were not aggressive. A great support of the ideas of social learning theory applied to aggression. But not only that, the results also support the idea of identification, with the little boys more likely to imitate males and the girls the females. In a study looking at how the media can influence aggressive behaviour through social learning processes, Williams observed children's play in a rural town in Canada, before and after the introduction of TV in the 80s. She found that both physical and verbal aggressive behaviour increased significantly. And Williams suggests that the children were imitating the aggression of the symbolic models, characters, they'd watched on TV. De-individuation. Our final social psychological explanation is de-individuation. This is the idea that when we're in a large crowd or when our identity is hidden, we lose our sense of self, our idea of ourselves as individuals. Festinger claims that this feeling turns into a loss of control. We'll then be more easily led by the group that we're a part of, even if that group's behaviour becomes aggressive. De-individuation can also be caused by or increased by the use of masks, uniforms and darkness. So what's the reason for this? Well, it's hard to be identified in a crowd. You don't know the people around you, they don't know you, and you will never meet them again. You're anonymous. Any feelings of personal responsibility and guilt fade away, knowing people are not judging you as a person. This is a reduction in public self-awareness. Ultimately, you feel you won't be held responsible for your actions, and that's what makes it easier to go along with the crowd. But we're also so focused on the crowd's actions, we don't reflect on our own principles and morality. This is how we would like to see ourselves, our private self-awareness. Losing the sense of our own individual values makes us much more easily follow the group's behaviour. De-individuation, evaluations. I'm going to evaluate de-individuation with Zimbardo. No, not the prison study. I know you might be tempted to use that with the uniforms and the high levels of aggression, but really, I don't think it works too well. They spent a number of days together and the de-individuation aspect, it's minimal. Instead, there is a less famous study in which Zimbardo used groups of four female participants and got them to shock a learner in a similar setup to Milgram's study. Now, this study was designed to really test de-individuation. In one condition, the group was completely de-individuated. They were not introduced to the other participants and they didn't speak. They were given oversized lab coats and had hoods with eye holes placed over their heads, so they were completely unidentifiable. The other group were introduced by name as they entered the room and were given oversized name badges. Zimbardo did find that de-individuation increased aggression, with the de-individuated participants shocking for twice as long as the individuated participants. Another study we can use is super weird and wouldn't have a chance of being carried out today. Gergen used groups of 8 participants and took them one at a time to a small padded room. Participants were not introduced to each other, but they were told there were no rules at all on what they could do for their hour in the room. There were 2 conditions. In one condition, the room was fully lit, and the second room was in complete darkness. Now, the researchers are listed in with microphones and watched with infrared cameras. In the lightroom condition, the strangers just generally had a very awkward hour. Some talking, but no intentional physical contact. The dark room was very different. 90% of the participants intentionally touched other people in the room, with 50% of participants going as far as hugging. Now, that's all the details you need to know for the exam, but reading this paper, this study got weird. Full of examples of deep emotional conversations and people crawling over each other in a pile on the floor. And 80% of the darkroom participants reporting sexual excitement. Keep in mind, this is complete strangers who have never seen each other. They're all completely in the dark. So does this study provide evidence that de-individuation lowers inhibitions? Yeah, I think so. Does that automatically lead to aggression? Well, no. This study is a pretty interesting example of how de-individuation can instead lead to increased intimacy. But the theory that de-individuation in the right conditions can lead to aggression really does have face validity. I don't know how far in the future you're watching this, but the January the 6th riots at the American Congress was only a few months ago for me. And as I was watching it, I couldn't help but think, okay, some of these guys have planned for this. But honestly, some of these people are normal Americans who've got carried away with the extreme behavior of the crowd, possibly through de-individuation. Not only rioters, but tribal societies have used masks and face paint in warfare for thousands of years. In modern times, armies all use standardized uniforms that strip away individuality. Evaluations. So when asked a question in this area, you could be asked to talk about just one social psychological explanation of aggression. Or you might be asked to talk about social psychological explanations in general, potentially talking about all three. So before we finish, I'm going to give you three general evaluations that you can alter depending on the demands of the question. So firstly, there are real practical applications of understanding how social factors lead to aggression. For de-individuation, we could use this knowledge to design cities in which people feel identified, so the use of CCTV and clear lighting. If we agree with social learning theorists that aggressive models make our children more aggressive through imitation, we might want to limit their exposure to aggressive models on TV and provide pro-social models instead. Or if they're exposed to aggressive models at home, stage an intervention. And if frustration is causing aggressive behaviour, perhaps give people the opportunity to achieve catharsis in a way that minimises harm. So perhaps playing aggressive computer games or sport. One criticism we can have is how these studies were conducted. Almost all of them only show short-term effects under lab conditions, when we're most interested in how people in the real world become long-term aggressive criminals due to their life experiences. These effects are really hard to study over the long term in the real world, because for social learning theory, the time between someone observing aggression and imitating could be a long time. And it's difficult to objectively measure frustration and de-individuation. And a final evaluation we can use is comparative. We've just covered the biological explanations for aggression, and there's significant evidence for a biological basis for aggression. So social-psychological is nurture, but evidence for nature can be found in genetic and neural abnormalities, so MOA and serotonin. This evidence suggests that nurture-based explanations are not a full explanation of why people display aggressive behaviour. Here is a real aggression exam question. Give it a go and see how you do. I want to thank everyone who supported this channel over on Patreon during the creation of the Aggression Unit. You help them make the development of these free A-level videos possible. If you are a PsychBoost patron at the neural level and above, you can access 6 bonus aggression tutorial videos over on psychboost.com. In them, I'll talk you through a model answer for the exam question, and I'll share some general exam tips based on the exam reports. Seventh patrons and above can access a printable poster, a 90-question quiz sheet covering the Aggression Unit, and an essay table. Neuron can get a set of worksheets and the script to this video. I've designed all of this to work alongside these videos and make a complete set of notes and revision materials. But for everyone else, like and subscribe so you don't miss these videos released right up to your exams.